Hi, I'm Mamta. Continuing chapter 3, today we'll be covering the aspect of effect of stress in general. So here we try to understand what is the impact of stress on us, what kind of damage, what kind of repercussions and consequences does stress has on our physical and psychological functioning. Now considering this aspect, we have the first point under it, the emotional aspect of stress. What kind of emotional effect is there on because of stress? First aspect that we have under emotional is, you know, when we are stressed out, we are normally having a lot of anxiety, worry, we get into depression, we get into tension, we are very irritable, and here a lot of mood swings are observed. A person can have a very low self-esteem because of stress. A person can be very confused, very upset, having a very low faith and low ability and thought about himself. That is the emotional impact of stress. Second factor that we have is the physiological impact. What effect of stress is there on our body? Now, as you're aware, when stress situation occurs, when we respond to a situation in a particular manner, which triggers off the release of certain hormones in our body, those hormones, epinephrine or norepinephrine, they result in activation of certain parts of our body, particularly the hands and the legs. The muscle movement starts, the digestion stops. So if a person is stressed out for most of the duration, what happens then is that the person's digestion gets affected, because most of the time the blood moves on to the extremities of the bodies, and because of that the digestion gets affected. It can also result in, as you're aware of, the sympathetic nervous system action. All the aspects of heart get activated, blood pressure get activated, a lot of sweating. All these aspects result in very high breathing also. If you ever consider the aspect of exam stress, when you are writing for an exam, what kind of breathing do you think you're having at that time? It's a very fast breathing. So that time, if you take a pause and slow down your breathing, automatically stress will release and the hormone secretion will stop. The changes in hormone will stop, and also it results in the changes in the lungs and the stomach. So in fact, stress impacts the whole body organs, all of the body. It's affected right from the brain to the legs. Third aspect is on the mind, the cognitive area. Now here, when we have, let's say, considering a maths problem, to understand the cognitive effect of stress, if I'm doing a maths problem, why do I need a music in the background? That is just to relax me, because probably I'm scared of maths. So I need something soothing to help me concentrate. Now, if there is stress most of the time, if a person is most of the time in a hyper state, that would mean the person's mind gets affected. The person always feels tired, feels there's a lot of burden on the person. The person feels that he's not able to concentrate on any particular thing. He's not able to attend to what is being told to him. He forgets. So a lot of memory lapses are there. A lot of reasoning and judgment errors are there. These are all the cognitive areas. Last impact on our functioning is the behavioral impact. The impact on the way we address and deal with situations outside. So here it might happen that a person feels very sleepy, the person is not having the energy to get up, the person cries a lot, the person is, you know, resorting to drugs or any particular behaviors which are not healthy for him. It could be comfort foods also. It could be the person gets very frustrated and shouts out at others. That could also be a way to vent out the behavioral aspect. So it could also mean that a lot of arguments are happening because the person is stressed out. So the person tends to vent out that frustration onto somebody else. These are all the behavioral aspects of stress. With this, we covered the impact of stress on our behavior. Now moving on to what impact of stress, like what is the relation of stress and health? Now here, when we talk about our lifestyle today, and we compare it to the lifestyle of our ancestors, we notice a stark difference. they had a very rigid routine. They had a very rigid routine, not just in terms of getting up at a particular time and going off to sleep at a particular time, but also in terms of the kind of food that they used to take, the kind of thoughts that they used to create for themselves. Comparing to them, if we look at it at us through our lifestyle, there's a stark difference. Now, looking at us, we are having a different lifestyle in terms of the time that we go off to sleep. Most of the people today are, you know, they get up at night and they sleep in the morning. That is the kind of lifestyle that we are having. So just imagine when we're not working in tune with nature, the way nature has made life for us, when we are having an opposite lifestyle, we are resisting the forces of nature, definitely it's going to affect our health. So people working in the call center are having major health related problems because of the change in lifestyle as well as a change in the kind of food that they are having. Now, daily stresses can result a person in a neglect in the person's health, because when a person is stressed out, he would only look in for comfort areas. It could be a distraction, a quick pleasure, or it could be the comfort foods. So whatever gives the person temporary pleasure, the person would go in for that. But overall, when we look at it, it results in a kind of a exhaustion in a person's life. A person is having burnout, which is exhaustion in all areas. It is a state of physical, emotional, and psychological exhaustion. Now, a lot of people, you know, feel a chronic fatigue. They feel tired most of the time without any reason, mentally very tired, emotionally drained out, physically not having the energy. That is known as burnout. That is the extreme stage of stress. Now, considering that, there's a model that we now have to move on to, which is known as the general adaptation syndrome. This model is a physiological model given by the father of stress, Hans Selye. Now, he observed the animals when they were given extreme situations like injections of insulin or high temperature and X-rays they were exposed to, rats were exposed to, and with that, their stress level was understood. Similar to that, the patients who were having chronic illness in mental hospitals or any kind of injury, they were also compared with, and it was understood the kind of reaction they give to stress, to any particular stressful situation. They had common responses. Now, with that, Hans Selye formulated a model, GAS model. The first aspect of this model is known as the alarm stage. Now, alarm means, like the term suggests again, any outside situation suddenly results in emergency and crisis situation. So immediately, hormonal system is triggered and hormones are released. So alarm would indicate that the body comes into action, into a fight or flight mode, either confronting a situation or, if not able to confront, withdrawing and running away and escaping from it. So that is the alarm stage. According to Hans Selye, the person then moves on to the second stage, which is known as a resistance stage. Now, once the body has started secreting hormones, after a limit, the body will get tired. So the body will start confronting it. The parasympathetic nervous system would want to take over and would want to shut down its system for rest, to restoring it to normalcy. Now, this stage is known as the resistance stage. Third stage that we have here is known as the exhaustion stage, what we understood in the concept of burnout also. Exhaustion basically means when the person is tired of resisting, now the body will collapse, it will give up. Now it doesn't have the energy or the resources to deal with this particular situation. It would result in blood pressure, any particular illness, or would result in death when a person collapses. Now this model is purely a physiological model and has been criticized for the same reason. And obviously because it does not consider any psychological factors. It does not consider any past experience. It does not consider any mental health, confidence, temperament in any such areas. That is the reason why it is not acceptable in totality. Now we have the concept of stress and how it is linked with illness. Now a lot of diseases, in fact, researchers have shown that most of the diseases are now stress related and they are known as psychosomatic illnesses. Soma refers to the body. Psycho refers to the mind. So body and mind are connected in that manner where any mental conflict results and shows itself in the body. It expresses itself through the body. So people going to doctors having blood pressure, they do not really have any physical damage, but it is basically the mental conflicts which result in the blood pressure. The same happens for people who are growing up the career ladder very fast. At 25, a person becomes a manager. Now, looking at his success, people are impressed, but look at the kind of damage it can result in, because the person has overworked and overstretched his abilities. He has achieved things faster, and that will definitely have an impact on his illness. So people now are having heart attacks at the age of 25 and 30, which was not heard of till the age of 60-70. So that is the kind of impact that is having on the health and resulting in a lot of illness. This branch of psychology that I'm talking about is known as psychoneuroimmunology. Psycho refers to the mind, neuro refers to the brain processes, and immunology refers to the immune system. Now, a person having HIV, who is diagnosed with HIV, may not have AIDS if his immune system is strong. So a person suffering from a terminal illness of cancer may be able to recover faster and completely if his immune system is strong. If he is able to work with his mind, because we can control our mind and we can make our immune system stronger. This branch is known as psychoneuroimmunology, and a lot of researchers have shown that our WBCs or leukocytes, which are the major determinants to ensure that we are fit and fine and do not fall prey to any illnesses, they are the ones which are the major reason behind our immunity. Now, these leukocytes or WBCs are comprising of three parts. First is the B cells. Now, these B cells are working with our immunity and ensuring that we do not fall ill. We have T cells. T cells ensure a lot of, you know, any outside invaders into our body. So what they do is they try and kill the antigens. Antigens are any kind of viruses that attack our body, by producing antibodies, and through these antibodies, these invaders in the bodies are killed. Similarly, we have the third category called the natural killer cells. Now, natural killer cells are basically having the natural capacity to attack the viruses or any kind of tumors in the body. These three comprises of the WBC, and WBC basically work for our immunity. So most of the time, people who are positive thinkers, people who are able to deal with stress with their faith about their life situations, they fall prey to less of stress and therefore are fit and fine for the rest of their life. And such people live longer and in a very healthy manner, because their habits, their thinking, their lifestyle is very, very positive. This is how stress is linked to our immune system. We have the last major topic of today, which is coping with stress. Now, coping as such is a dynamic, situation-specific reaction to stress. How a person is able to analyze his skills and abilities, analyze the kind of resources he has, and is able to deal with the situation using those resources. So, what kind of strategies a person uses to deal and handle stress? First category that we have here is given by Endler and Parker. These two psychologists have given three subcategories. First is the task-oriented strategy, second is the emotional-oriented strategy, and third is the avoidance-oriented coping strategy. Now, task-oriented basically means that if I'm faced with a particular challenge, how do I deal with that situation? So my approach is to identify that this is a problem, accept it with this particular issue, and then try and look for different kind of information to prioritize, to deal with that situation and to handle it by attacking the problem itself. So I am having a very head-on approach, that I know there's a family crisis, there's a family conflict, and my task is to look for different ways to handle that particular problem. So I'm not running away from that problem. I'm not feeling helpless or inadequate in that particular situation. I'm directly attacking the problem itself, and this is a very, very healthy approach. Second is the emotion-oriented strategy. Emotion deals with if I'm able to generate a lot of hope, if I'm able to vent out my emotions and express my emotions when I'm feeling stressed out, I'm able to share it with somebody and communicate and feel better. That's the emotional-oriented strategy. Third is avoidance. Now, this strategy means that I'm minimizing the seriousness of a particular situation. I'm distracting myself. I'm just making myself busy and escaping myself from the situation, like watching TV, going off to sleep, going out for a vacation. That is all avoidance-oriented strategy. Second category that we have is by two psychologists, Lazarus and Folkman. Now, they have talked about a problem-focused strategy and a emotion-focused strategy. So, problem-focused again deals with the way I handle a particular situation. If I think about handling a particular situation and I'm able to stay with that experience of discomfort, I will come up with the solutions and answers. So, I'm able to think about the positives of how to handle a situation, and I'm able to understand the situation in totality, considering what can be done in this particular case. Second is the emotional focused. Now, here the focus is only on either sulking behavior or feeling irritable or crying about the things that you can't do much about, which are not under your control. So that is a very emotion focused strategy. So covering up today, to summarize, we understood the effect of stress on our body, relating it to health and illness, and the two different categories of coping styles under which we had the subcategories given by the psychologist. That's about it for today. Thank you.